Hello, everyone. Welcome to Tranquil, a place where we all gather to relax and enjoy the company of great minds. As Robin Wright correctly said, a great life is to be ebb and flow. And everyone knows how to flow. You know, we all have been in that state many times. And maybe you find the flow at work, or maybe you find flow in your garden, maybe in your kitchen, or with your kids or family, or doing a jigsaw puzzle. So this week, Tranquil is fortunate to bring Sky Nelson Isaac, who is an author of Living in Flow. He's a multi-talented. Sky is a physicist. He's also a musician, actually, and he will talk about living in the flow. Sky, it's our pleasure to have you here. Love to learn what your journey has been so far to this point, and also love to learn how you define synchronicity, and can you give us some examples of it?
Thank you, Prasoon. It's great to be here. And what really helps me about this study of flow, and specifically the study of synchronicity, which I think is a coincidence which leads us into flow, might even be a disruption in our day, but by adjusting to it, we get into flow. And what's really helpful about it is that it provides a sense that we're not just dealing with problems in the moment, but we're actually healing. We're actually growing. We're actually evolving ourselves in some important way. I like to think of it as up-leveling ourselves, like in a video game, getting to the next chapter of our lives. And we do that not through the easy parts necessarily, but through the hard parts. It's challenges that show up in our life, which can be seen as synchronistic, as meaningful, that when you look at them in a context that's bigger than that, context of, well, actually, yeah, right now I'm trying to make enough money to survive, but I'm also trying to learn how to be more patient with my family. I'm also trying to learn how to be more compassionate with myself. I'm also trying to learn how to have a nicer inner experience when I deal with stress so that I'm more in control of my own experience. And these are all the things that are happening even underneath the circumstances. And so flow and synchronicity, the study of these things gives us some context in which we can see difficulty happening. So just to give you a little my background, I grew up studying spiritual traditions with Satchitananda, Swami Satchitananda. My parents were students of his. He's a yogic master. And then I studied physics at University of California, Berkeley for undergraduate. I was a teacher, high school teacher for a number of years. I went on to work in the software industry and did some engineering and then project management, and then went back to grad school as a physicist at San Francisco State University, and now have been researching, and for the past two decades, been researching the fundamentals of quantum mechanics, what we call quantum foundations, the foundations of the field, to understand what is space, what is time, and how is it relevant to our understanding of the cosmos.
That's amazing, Sky. So scientists and philosophers and others have studied synchronicity over the years. So who are the few notable ones and what did they make of this phenomenon?
Carl Jung was one of the first really pioneers. And there was actually a man before that who was very much marginalized. He tracked a series of events in his life that were, seemingly threaded together, like similarities in what he would see this someone wearing a red dress, how many times he saw someone wearing a red dress. But that was, the world wasn't ready for that, and his methods weren't quite ready. And I can give that name later if I remember it. But then Carl Jung came along, and he was a psychologist and understood at a deeper level what might be happening, and named it synchronicity. And a synchronicity, according to him, is a broad range of different phenomena in which the outer world reflects something going on in the inside, something a patient or a person is thinking about or feeling or dreaming about shows up in an uncanny way in the outer world. And then there are some authors, physicist David Peat, and wrote a book called Synchronicity or about synchronicity. Mark Holland and Leslie Combs wrote a book about synchronicity, which is very good. A business consultant that I know named Ann Betts has done some really good trainings on getting to the seven levels of effectiveness, and synchronicity is the top level of effectiveness. And I can also recommend people like Philip Mary and Joseph Jaworski, who have looked at business applications of synchronicity.
amazing. So, you know, I think that's the you know, with that background, one of the unique contributions of your book, Living in the Flow, is that you link flow with synchronicity, you know, which is very unique. So can you first explain what you mean by flow, you know, and tell us what is your definition of flow, and tell us how you think it relates to synchronicity?
Yeah, so Mihai, Csikszentmihalyi, wrote a book called Flow, The Psychology of Optimal Experience. And that set the stage for understanding this idea that humans can thrive at an optimal level by getting into alignment with whatever it is that they're doing. And he defines, the definition I pulled out of his book is, flow is a state where we transcend the duality between trying to take control and trying to let go of control. So if we spend our time trying to like figure out if should I take control of the situation or should I surrender, then we're caught in this back and forth and we never quite know what's the right thing to do. And a lot of us are habitually one way or the other. We try and take control over everything in our lives, or we just let go and, you know, we sort of let things happen however they happen. We give up control. What flow is about transcending the worry. Because when we're stuck trying to figure out whether we should control things, we're actually stuck in the state of worry. And when you're in flow, as you might know from experiences of, you know, when you get really into baking or really into being with your children or really into jogging, whatever it is for you, you stop worrying about whether you're in control or not. You enter into a dynamic relationship with the situation you're in. So that's essentially what flow does for us and how Csikszentmihalyi defined it. And I do want to go back and state my definition of a synchronicity. A synchronicity, in my view, is a little bit simpler or more specific than Carl Jung's view. A synchronicity is a meaningful event, which appears meaningful because it leads to a situation or an experience you're seeking to have. Mm-hmm. So when we have an obstacle in our life, it might seem like it's in the way, but it actually might be leading us to an experience we're seeking to have. And when we can see it that way, we're more likely to get into flow and be able to adapt.
Thank you for sharing that. And how do you distinguish between synchronicity and coincidence? You know, are they, you know, how what are the kind of, where do you draw the line?
Yeah, I think ultimately there's no hard line. It's a spectrum. I've got a synchronicity I'll tell you about today where I met somebody against all odds whatsoever across the world. And it was somebody I was actually trying to meet. And that's like a once in a lifetime experience. But that's obviously a synchronicity, but what about when I'm, you know, when my car battery dies, is that a synchronicity or is that just bad luck? So what I'm trying to provide is a way to look at these experiences in terms of how they make you feel and how they remind you of who you want to be. Any situation that reminds you of who you really want to be can be thought of as meaningful and synchronistic.
That's very interesting. So what are the few, misconceptions that people might have about what it means to live in flow? You know, I think can somebody be in the delusion of living in the flow? So how do we identify what is flow and what is not flow? It's just our natural state, actually. Yeah.
Well, you know, we all gravitate towards certain experiences. You know, we gravitate towards feeling good, whatever that means for us. We gravitate towards feeling pleasure, towards feeling not under stress. So it can be hard to think of flow as, you know, when I'm stressed a lot, like I gotta get out of that. I gotta think positive thoughts. So I think people have a misconception that flow and synchronicity are these positive things, that you should get rid of the negative so you can experience these positive things. But it's different than that. It's flow is a neutral experience, or I should say synchronicity is a neutral experience. Synchronicity is either a quote unquote good or bad experience. It's one that leads you to an experience you're seeking to have. So I'm sure that each of you can think of a time when you wanted something really bad in your life, maybe a deeper relationship with someone in your life, for instance. And what had to happen in order for that to come about is a difficult experience, you know, an argument. But when the argument came full circle, you ended up being closer to that person. And so flow, what I'd like to clear up is a misconception that flow is somehow about getting to the easy emotions. Flow is really about getting to be unafraid of all your emotions and allowing them to not get blocked. When we get out of flow, it's because we're blocking some experience we don't want to have. some obstacle that's in our way or some grief or some resentment that we don't want to feel, and it stops us from getting to the next thing and the next thing and being in flow.
That's a very interesting point that you brought, Sky. So I think you brought a very important point of how do we live in flow when we are in a relationship, you know, like, so how can folks leverage flow? You know, I know flow comes out of your individuality, right? Out of your state of being, but how do we leverage that in a relationship actually?
I think for me, relationships are the number one place where flow becomes valuable. You know, so much of relationship, and I think this is just both in our personal relationships, in our business relationships, and in our political relationships, and in every way that we interact with each other, so much of our relationships is about how we respond to other people. And I'm going to show you in a minute a tree model of how synchronicity unfolds in our lives. And in this tree model, you start at one point, but there's all sorts of future possibilities, like branches of a tree. Mm-hmm. And out of all those possibilities, when you start seeing how many different possible outcomes there are, and if one of those is blocked because so-and-so says you can't do this plan, you know, if your boss says, I'm not going to let you go ahead with this plan, and you start pounding against that and getting really mad, that's not in flow. Instead, if you see, okay, well, that's an obstacle. What other branches are there to this tree that can lead me to the outcome I want? What are other ways of accomplishing this that are not limited by what other people are telling me I can't do? That's how flow allows us to stop resisting and pushing against other people unnecessarily and find our own power in our own creativity and adaptability.
That's very interesting. So one of the problems that we have right now is the COVID-19 mediated isolation, right? So nothing is flowing but a virus that is flowing, right? So I think in this situation, how have you managed the flow? I know you are a musician, so you know that's itself a flow. You know, writers can write, so that's still they can get to the flow. But what would be your advice to the, you know, community? How can they maintain to still be in a flow state and follow the, you know, social distancing as well?
Well, let me share a story of a difficulty that I went through that ended up being a really transformative synchronistic experience, but was painful. And again, we're looking for context. How is this situation helping me understand myself better, regardless of what the situation in the outside world is? Because that's how I become a more accomplished, creative, effective person. So I was having to do some work on my house. I had a problem in one of the bedrooms and we hired someone to do the work. And I was pretty busy with my own work. So one morning I left home and told the person working on it, yeah, go ahead. We're really, really concerned about this one thing going right. And I expressed a deep sort of an emotion, right? I was attached to this thing going right. And when I got home that day, I found it had gone exactly wrong. And it was because he had misinterpreted what I said, because I was so determined to get my point across that I kind of overdid my description. And it actually helped create a problem for ourselves. It wouldn't have been there if I had just sort of stayed out of the picture. Mm-hmm. And so this was really painful to see that my own emotion had gotten in the way and created the very problem I was trying to avoid. And it was actually took us quite a long time to fix that problem. And at one point I really just gave up. I had some tears come and I said to myself, okay, I see that everything I've tried to do, every time I've tried to grab hold of this and take charge, it's gotten worse. And I've created more and more problems. So how do I let go a little bit? And I'm not quite sure exactly, it wasn't some big moment. It was a gradual loosening up of my grip. And suddenly the person wrote back and said, okay, well, here's what we can do. We've got a new idea. And then I was able to find a new contractor, which we'd been trying to get for quite a while. And that came about. And within about 3 weeks, the problem was on track to be solved, whereas it had been unsolved for 2 or 3 months. So there's a way in which challenges have come into my life, and COVID-19 being a big one, which challenged me to check in more often with myself. How am I managing the daily relationships that I'm in? Am I responding? What are the emotions I'm feeling? Am I responding to the situation out of my anxiety, out of my worry? Or am I aware of my worry, so I'm not like acting in reaction to it, but I'm also holding the other parts of myself, my compassion for myself, my compassion for others. And if I'm not able to, you know, at least if I can see the worry that I'm coming from, if I can feel that tension in my chest or my belly, you know, when I feel anxious, and actually go in and understand that a little bit more before reacting to somebody on a phone call or jumping into an argument with somebody. You know, when we feel stress and tension in that argument, there's probably something going on inside of ourselves that's before the argument that's causing us to be upset or unhappy. And it's about getting in touch with that first before we go out into the relationship and cause bigger problems than the ones we already have.
Thank you, Sky. That's very valuable information. And the last question that I will ask is that I think you may laugh at this, but I think some of us are, so now we are all confined at home, right? So, yeah. So before I knew that I have to drive back home and that's when my work ends, right? But now I get into the flow and now I'm working overnight and getting up and working all the time. So this, I'm in this constant flow all the time. So how do you advise, some of us who are in this constant flow to find, to get out of that flow and find a work-life balance? You know, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, one thing that I've been really learning is that we seem to have, I have a sense of guilt around doing what I want. Like, I feel like I'm supposed to do what I should do. I'm supposed to do my job, and it's supposed to look a certain way, and I'm supposed to do it during certain hours. And there's a sort of a taboo around, like, well, what do I want to do? It's as if, like, if I did what I wanted to do, I would never sit down and get to work or something like that. But the truth for me is that I actually would work pretty hard if I did what I want to do. But there are some times when what I want to do is to go work on a puzzle with my daughter or go play outside with her. Or what I want to do is go make a dinner. So the more I can check in with and be open to what I want to do, like, what do I really want? Like, check into that feeling. What does it feel like to want something, to want to do something, like something simple? Like taking a break or, you know, watching TV for 20 minutes. Like, maybe that's what you want. And I think that can be really useful because there's a point, you know, on one hand, we want to keep working because we want to finish the project. And on the other hand, we want to take a break. And the more we can listen to the part of ourselves that actually just wants to take a break and identify why we're not doing that. Maybe we're worried about the project. If we can identify that worry and then touch into making space for what it is that we want in life, I guarantee you, you'll come back to the work at the right time. Because at some point you'll be like, oh, I want to go finish that project. And I think just keep coming back to what do I really want for myself right now can be a really good guide for getting into flow.
Great. Yeah, no, that, thank you, Sky. Thank you. That's, I think that gives us some, framework to work. So ladies and gentlemen, I give you Sky Nelson Isaac, author of Living in a Flow, physician, musician, and he will talk about living in a flow, the science of synchronicity, and how your choices shape your world. Sky, the floor is all yours. Thank you.
Thank you. So let's have some fun. That's another word for what I was just describing, getting comfortable with fun, even when we're stuck with stress and worry in the world. So the topic I'm going to talk about is the physics of synchronicity and the tree of possibilities. And I've been fascinated with synchronicity as a meeting point between my own spiritual inquiry as a younger person and my scientific education as an older person. And I want to share with you an image here. Oh, this is my book, Living in Flow, The Science of Synchronicity and How Your Choices Shape Your World. It came out last year. And in it, I go into these topics. I go into the science as well as the how to live more in flow and make use of these principles in your life the best we can. So let me tell you a story about synchronicity. This is an example of synchronicity in my life. I was 20 and I was going backpacking around in the European continent for about 6 months. And I had a good friend who was traveling around the Middle East. And we said, well, as long as we're in that part of the world, let's meet up. So we made a plan to meet in Greece. But things were not working out as I had planned. I got sick partway through my travels and I had to head home. So my flight was out of Paris. I got on a train to go to Paris and then I was going to plan to fly home from there. But meanwhile, my friend, whose name was Dana, got sick of waiting for me to call. Because this was before cell phones. It wasn't very easy to call from the road with a backpack. And she got what turned out to be a synchronistic invitation. Somebody approached her and said, do you want to go to Paris for the weekend? Now, of course, to her in that moment, that sounds almost like an obstacle. because she's waiting to hear from me. And if she leaves and goes to Paris, she's going to miss my call. So she's thinking of it like an obstacle, but she thankfully decided to go on the trip anyway. And, you know, we can never know in the moment whether or not something is actually going to be beneficial to us or not. And so there's a level of opening up ourselves, opening up our hearts to like, where are we being led right now? And so she went to Paris. And in my mind, there was no chance that she was in Paris. I wasn't thinking about that at all. But as I walked, I had 24 hours in Paris and I went to the Louvre Museum. And as I walked through the Louvre at one point, I looked over and there was this person that looked just like Dana. And I'm thinking to myself, that just doesn't make any sense because Dana's not here. She's in Paris. But what I want you to, I mean, she's in Israel. What I want you to think about is the world around you as an unknown, undetermined branching tree. And so from my point of view, I hadn't talked to her in about a month. And so there's many different ways her life could have gone in that time period. There's many different places she could be. And most of them are probably near where she was in Israel. I wouldn't expect her to be in Paris, but apparently one of the branches on the tree had her being in Paris. And so that gives us the possibility of then meeting synchronistically by accident in Paris. Now, one of the questions that has nagged at me for all these years is, can we be so close to a synchronicity that we can like almost get it and then just miss it by 10 feet? Like, what if I had not gone into that room to meet her? And I began to see synchronicity as life's way of weaving our lives together, of showing us, you know, when we get close to each other, life's going to make us find each other. So if we didn't have synchronicity, we would just kind of pass each other like ships in the night all the time, miss each other and miss important opportunities in our life. And this process, what I'm going to describe as flexibility or flexible histories, allows the universe around us, the people in our lives, to adjust their timelines, to adjust their experiences to meet us. So let me explain what I mean. In this situation, I have a choice to go right or straight down this hallway. And this is a floor plan of the Louvre Museum. And if I go straight, I can meet up with one of her branches. If I go right, I can meet up with a different branch. So I go straight, and it turns out I meet up with her, and we bumped into each other. And her friend looked at me as I'm staring and said, "Don't look now, but there's this really weird guy staring at you." So thankfully, she did look, and we met up and spent the next 12 hours together at the airport before my flight. And just to tie up the story, she and I eventually got married and now have a young daughter. So she, you know, became and already was a very important part of my life. We had meant to meet in Greece. We ended up accidentally meeting spontaneously in Paris, the city of lovers, of course. So what if I had chosen a different path? What if I had taken a right down that hallway? Would we have not gotten married later in life? Would we have not been on that branch of the tree? Well, because the tree has these three branches, it's possible for it to adjust. When I take a right down the hallway, I can meet up with a different branch of her. And that means a different history sort of falls into place. And so what we're going to get used to the language being, you know, that particular reality fell into place. That particular circumstance fell into place based on the choice that I made. So we're talking about flexible histories. A synchronicity, here's where we get to define it. It's a meaningful circumstance which becomes more likely because it leads to an experience that you're seeking to have. And I say not intending to have, because sometimes our intentions are unclear. We're not aware of what our intentions are. So, and this is an experience we may or may not be conscious of that we're somehow seeking to have, consciously or unconsciously. And the apple on the tree represents a synchronicity, represents the outcome we're seeking to have. So if the experience I'm seeking to have is to be connected to this person, like Dana in my example, then there are lots of different ways that can happen. It could be in Greece, but it can also apparently be in Paris. And on the left-hand branch here, you can see this tree of all the possibilities with the apples, the red apples. There's also some green pears. There's lots of different types of experiences you could be seeking. Let's say all the apples on the left-hand branch represent me meeting her in Paris. I could meet her at the bar, I could meet her at a museum, I could meet her at a club. But it actually doesn't matter where I meet her. It's the experience of getting the apple, the experience of us connecting that matters. So what I want you to encourage you to do is think about, what experience are you seeking to have? What experience are you anticipating in your life? And how is your anticipation of that experience influencing the sorts of decisions you make and the sorts of synchronicities or meaningful coincidences that happen in your life? And becoming more aware of what it is that you're anticipating, what kinds of experiences you're seeking, and when they're showing up in your life in ways that you might not be expecting. And so, to bring this back to the conversation about me and Dana in Paris, the synchronicity might be when she got the invitation from her friends to go to Paris in the first place. It was this out of the blue invitation. She had no idea why she would go except just to have fun with her friends. She had no idea that it would lead to all these apples on the tree. And yet when she did it, she found that we ended up meeting, which was definitely something she wanted to do. So a synchronicity is a meaningful event because it leads to an experience we're seeking to have. Now, to just touch on a little bit of the science, what I'm trying to show in my work is that the apples at the top of the tree have some weight to them. Like an apple is heavy and it will weigh down the branches that it's sitting on. And that means it adds to the likelihood of that branch, if the weight is associated with the likelihood. And so this left-hand branch has a lot of apples, and it has to do with us meeting in Paris. And that whole branch becomes heavier because of the apples, which makes the thing that gets us there heavier. It makes the synchronicity more likely to happen. So I like to think of it this way. When we make choices in our life, we set targets in the future. We're not just choosing, you know, our reaction to the moment. We're also setting a target for what we want to experience in the future. I chose to try and meet up with Dana in Greece, and I set targets for that kind of connection happening, which allowed us to then the path gets filled in for us. And this is the key part. Those apples at the top fill in the path for us so that now synchronicities start showing up on a more likely basis and help us get to those very outcomes. So let me give one more example of how this works in practice, at least in my experience. So imagine that you're in New York City and you're trying to get to a show. You're going to get on the subway, and we're going to look at this tree from a more detailed perspective. Now, I want to get to the show because I want to experience the fun and the joy of the show, the theater production, whatever that is, the sights and sounds of the play, the taste of popcorn, the connection with a friend. But I get into the station, the subway station, and I find that I hear the train pulling in. And this is the last train I can catch to be on time for the show. But I know I'm not going to get to that train because I've still got to buy my ticket and walk down the stairs. So the question is, do I run for the train? I know I'm not going to catch it. Do I run for it? And this is a broader question in our lives. You know, how does our investment of our own energy, our investment of our own commitment, how does it affect or influence the likelihood of the synchronicities that we experience? This is a question I've asked myself since very early on. You know, how much influence do I have over the experiences that come my way, the opportunities? And so what I'm going to suggest is that when you run for the train and when you run for things in your life, when you invest yourself full-heartedly, you actually influence the likelihood of synchronicities that help you out, that fill in the path for you to get to that end result. So let's say you run for the train. That's you with a happy face. And there's two possibilities. Either the subway waits for you and you catch it, or you don't catch the subway. Now, in each possibility, you may or may not be on time. And I'm trying to do a scientific diagram here so you can see how this works from a logical left brain perspective. If you catch the subway, you're likely to be on time. So I'm going to place a heavy apple there. And if you catch the subway, you're not likely to be late. So I'm going to place the light apple on the far left-hand branch. And then, of course, if I don't catch the subway, if I go right, then I'm less likely to be on time. So I got a small apple there. Do you see that weighting of the apples, how it relates to our logical interpretation of what's going on? Now, if that was everything, then that's how we see things right now, and it wouldn't affect the results. But what I'm suggesting is that when you anticipate an experience, when you anticipate being in the theater, when you anticipate the feeling of contentment and joy and relaxation that you want to have and connection with your friend that you want to see, you're actually placing apples, you're choosing your targets, you're placing weight on the tree through that anticipated experience. You could say it's intention, but it may or may not be conscious. So I think of it as anticipated experience. And when I anticipate the feeling of having fun at the play, I'm placing apples on the branches of the tree on which I'm on time for the play, because those are the only ones in which I have that experience. So now when I combine these apples, you can see that there's only one branch on which there's two big apples. The others have small apples. And so overall, I've got a big apple on the on-time subway branch. And when I combine those, this is just sort of showing you how the math would work. You get a bigger apple on the subway branch and a smaller apple on the no subway branch. So what this shows is that you can calculate a higher likelihood of having the experience that we're seeking to have. And how does this work in the subway? Well, let's just say the train is about to pull away and a bike can't get his bike in the door and the doors get jammed. And so it has to wait a few seconds while you run down the stairs and jump on. But because you were running, you can catch that opportunity. So it's important to be investing ourselves in order to catch those opportunities that are about to get away from us. Or maybe there could be some debris in the tracks that they had to stop and clear. And so something can happen unrelated to you that gives you the chance to catch the opportunity. And then you catch the subway and you're on time to the play. So that's a process I call meaningful history selection. It's the way in which the more meaningful outcomes become more likely because you're actually anticipating those experiences. You're anticipating having those experiences. So I think I'll jump ahead here, and I do have a talk coming up on the 28th, which you can join and get more information, but it's already 2:10. Shall we go to the closing here? How are we doing, Prasoon?
Yeah, your call, Sky, I think.
Okay. Well, I'll just share that the work I'm doing essentially emphasizes that our world works very much like a virtual reality-like world, because objects and people and things outside of your observation do not have any kind of physical definite state until you observe them. And this is a process similar to what's called optimistic synchronization in gaming. In a gaming environment, you have two people playing a game across the world from each other. Each person has their own laptop, and they are trying to synchronize their worlds. So one world is doing its thing, and the other world is doing its thing, and they're trying to synchronize those. And to make the virtual worlds compatible, computers share only the relevant information. And the histories of other players are flexible until the data is received, and then an entire chain of events falls into place. This is what I call retroactive event determination. So let me go to just let you know that the model of the fence is, I think, useful. Life is like a fence. We fill in the gaps with what we think is going on. Your fence posts in your life are the observations you make of people, the real connections you have, the interactions you have with people. Those are the things that you know to be true. Everything else in between, everything you're not observing in the world, is evolving into many branches of the tree. And so it really reminds me to open up my mind about what's possible in a given moment when I think about all the things I'm assuming in between those fence posts that I'm assuming are happening a certain way, but actually are just evolving into possibilities waiting for me to make my choices so they can fall into place one way or the other in a more meaningful way. So let me take you to an exercise here, a brief exercise from Challenge to Flow. When we can see the world as being responsive to us, when we can see the way in which situations show up to us in response to the choices that we're making, to the types of courageous choices we're making, the types of ways we're choosing to live our best, to speak our mind, to be open and authentic and vulnerable with people, and we see situations showing up in our life which reflect that, the synchronicities are the moment-by-moment experiences that help us get to another level of experience, to heal from our past trauma, our past way of doing things. When we can pay attention to the synchronicities and allow ourselves to be redirected in life, we're more likely to feel flow, to feel an alignment with the circumstances rather than thrown off by them. And this goes for right now with COVID-19 as well. There's obstacles we come up against every day, disruptions in our workflow, disruptions in our financial life, disruptions in our relationship. And the more we can tune into what it is we're really feeling and understand how we operate best, the more we can bring our best skills to our difficult experiences. So I want to encourage you to recognize that you are someone who already knows how to flow. Think about a time in your life when you have flowed naturally. This might be in your career or in your family or with your friends and romance or your hobby or health or finances. In my case, it's definitely not home projects, maybe vacation. So think of a place in your life where you naturally feel like things are easy and they flow together. And think of an example of this. I can think with my family, you know, an example is we recently got a puzzle out, a really difficult puzzle, and just conquered it. I tell you, we're conquering it. And it's easy, much easier than some of my experiences with home projects or my career, let's say. So what's an area for you that you have flow in your life? And what are three feelings that you have? Three adjectives. This could be, you might be confident, you might be excited, you might be committed. What are three feelings you have when you're in this flow state? When I'm doing a puzzle with my family, I'm really present. I'm thinking deeply about things, but I'm also not taking it too seriously. There's a lot of humor. So those would be three adjectives I would use. And then, what's your method? You have a method for getting into flow. You just might not be aware of it yet. So what do you do to set yourself up for success in this area? You know, with my family, with doing this time together, I've gotten better in the past few months at just bookmarking a 20-minute period while I step away from my work and go be with my family to do something fun. And I'll aim for something fun in particular, something I'm really excited about doing. So a method for me is setting aside small periods of time when I can prioritize something that gets me into flow. So identify three methods that you have that get you into flow naturally in this part of your life. And now I want you to identify a challenge area. I already shared that I have sort of a challenge with home projects and getting into flow, so that could be one that I would use. An area of your life where you feel stuck, where things seem to go wrong, where you want to have more flow. And what is the feeling? Again, list three adjectives that go with this. You might feel frustrated, impatient, unworthy, insecure. Okay, so now we're going to bring it all together. I want you to get comfortable, maybe close your eyes if you want. And I want you to feel what it feels like to be in your challenge area. I want you not just to picture it in your mind and write it down on paper, but to actually feel the emotions. Picture yourself doing this challenge and feel the impatience, feel the frustration. Allow it to enter your chest as a sensation and fill your body with cortisol or whatever it is. Just allow yourself to go there. It sucks, I know, but this is how we adjust it. Because now I want you to take the feeling that you have from your flow area and feel that. While you're still picturing your challenge area, feel the excitement. Feel the commitment. Or the confidence. You're still picturing your challenge area, but you're feeling something different that you associate with your flow experiences. You're reassociating your challenge experience with a different set of feelings. You're reassociating your challenge experience with the feelings you have when you're in flow. And do this with your methods as well. Maybe your method is to sit down for 20 minutes at a time and just set aside time to work on something. Imagine doing that in your challenge area. Maybe you're, the way you do it is by creating a nice cup of tea or coffee for yourself and sitting down in a quiet corner and working on something. Maybe imagine doing that with your challenge area. Maybe you're really patient with yourself and you have a great sense of humor in your flow area. Picture doing that with your challenge area. You're imagining yourself undergoing this challenge area for you, but doing it with the techniques and the feelings that you have when you're in flow. So the takeaway here is that by simply applying the familiar ways we already know how to accomplish our flow areas, we can set the stage for helpful coincidences to assist us in our challenge areas. And you can start experiencing the feelings and the methods of flow in the areas where you typically stumble and get in your own way. You know, it starts with the feelings. Everything, you know, real change comes back to how we feel inside, because that's what causes us to take action. And so my work is really about reconnecting us with our ability to not be afraid of our feelings, to navigate them, and to remain resilient and able to get up in the morning and do the work that we need to do. And flow is about allowing ourselves to do what we need to do to stay in that zone. Maybe it means taking a break. Maybe it means still working and not having dinner with our family. It's, you know, it's whatever is right for us in the moment. And it's a process of getting better at finding what that is for ourselves. It's unique to each of us. It's unique to the moment. You can't plan for flow. You have to get into the habits of having techniques to keep dropping into it. So you can find my book at the website livinginflowbook.com. And I do have an upcoming event that was supposed to be at a bookstore here in the Silicon Valley, but it's online now, so anyone can attend. And it's a 2-hour workshop where I get to go into more detail and answer more questions, and you get to see some more of the science involved here. So that's on May 28th in the evening. I invite you to look that up online. We can provide that in the notes as well. And I do have a course that provides this tool and a number of other tools that allow you to have more facility with seeing the synchronicities in your life, seeing the obstacles that are coming up against as possible ways forward, and not getting thrown off by them. And these are tools that help you develop emotional resiliency to really see life with fresh eyes when you're at your struggling times. And you can find that at the URL youthrivehere.com/livinginflow. And my organization is called the Synchronicity Institute. We study synchronicity from an academic point of view and also from a public outreach point of view to try and share with people how to use this in their lives. Thank you so much for joining, and I'm available for conversation if you'd like to ask questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Sky, for that blissful exercise and amazing talk, actually. So I know a lot of everybody who heard your talk, I think they have just one question came out of their mind, and I would just ask, I'll ask the first question and then I'll open for others. So the question is, so you describe, synchronicity. So have you ever thought, you talked about the parallel universes, right? So we have, so what if you did not meet your future wife there and you met somebody else? Is universe is planning, or in some parallel universe, Sky is living that life? Have you given thought? Is a philosophical question, but I think everybody had that kind of a thought, actually.
It's really important. There's a, when people jump onto this many worlds idea, the many worlds theory, they jump to that there's many versions of ourselves, but we understand the world as information now. And we've gotten a better understanding of information and what that means. Like, the tree of possibilities is an informational representation of the world. It's not actual versions of me, because it's defined from everybody's point of view. Each person has their own tree in which they're evolving. And when our trees meet, we have consistency. We share an ever-widening web of correlations between our worlds. So it's not like it's a fake world. We each live in the real world, but it's not objective in the same way that we like to think of. So there's no, I strongly do not agree with the idea that there's another version of me somewhere that's living a different life, whether it's better or worse. I think that misses the point that the world is defined from each individual's point of view. You have to have a perspective in order to describe the world. And therefore, your perspective is your physical life, the life you're leading, has a certain perspective on this tree of possibilities. And which branch you're going to get is the whole question of how you make choices. It becomes really important to think about how we make choices. And the simple answer is you make choices by getting really clear on what it is you're feeling and what you're going for in life, and getting better at making choices that are in alignment with what you want. A lot of times when we're not clear about how we feel, we sort of make sabotaging choices, you know, so the clearer we can get about our emotional state and our, you know, understanding of how we feel inside and what we want for ourselves, and then align our actions with that, then we have situations falling into our path, which are going to be helpful in that regard. I will say one other thing. There's a concept called counterfactual definiteness, and it's been proven in the laboratory that there is no such thing as what would have happened if. Mm-hmm. There's no actual other version of reality happening that would have happened if you had made a different choice. Mm-hmm. So that's really interesting that we can actually show in the laboratory that question doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, that's, you know, that's a very, very good point. I think actually, so our world vision is, you know, it remains the same. So I just wanted that clarification from you. I think it's basically just all boils up to, the effort level that you put in to, you know, and then universe actually resonates with the possibilities, right? So I think that's is that rightly said, Sky?
Yeah,
or
I think so. Okay,
cool.
I think so. Yeah, that's well put.
Any questions, comments on Sky's, you know, talk and his exercise?
Thank you very much for that exercise. It was very useful to reassociate, the pleasant with the not necessarily pleasant.
Yeah.
I had a question about, like, when I picture an enlightened person, I think of somebody who won't run for the train, who's not so attached to the outcome that they run for the train. So.
Yeah,
you're saying also that at the same time you're attached. Maybe you're not attached to this specific outcome. You're attached to something general about going to the show and having joy, rather than the specific thing of getting to that particular show at that particular time.
Yeah, maybe it's the difference between the word attached and committed. You're committed to a certain experience, and you're doing what needs to be done in order to, you know, demonstrate that commitment. You're not attached to whether you catch the train or not, because a lot of times you're not going to catch the train, and then you don't go into a state of negativity because you're not attached. Mm-hmm.
That's good. So that there's no room then for negativity, for guilt, right? Because you know you tried, essentially.
And right. Guilt becomes an unnecessary result of what, you know, the thinking that we have. And my experience is, you know, we can choose to feel guilty, but there's actually no benefit to it. It doesn't get us closer to our goal. And so there's a lot here for me about choosing how I'm going to feel, and then how effective is that emotion in guiding my next action.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for asking. It's a good question.
Yeah, Rupesh here. Is it the synchronicity is like accepting a destiny?
Is synchronicity accepting a destiny?
Yeah.
I think these questions are, you know, this work is really aligned with the question of what is destiny. In the Hindu tradition of, you know, there's the concept of karma. And I mean, I've been exposed to the idea of karma my whole life, and yet I feel like it's still so subtle that I'm probably going to not do it justice by talking about it. But karma is, in a sense, related to what we're talking about here, because I'm talking about the cosmos being responsive. I'm saying that the world we live in is responding to the choices we make. It's bringing us situations which are helping us get to the experiences we want to have. And that's one way to look at, you know, the situations that are traumatic, like COVID-19. How is this situation going to be a stepladder for us to get to where we want to be as a civilization? Or where we want to be, let's just say, as human beings individually, because that's what we can have control over. And so in that sense, it is related to destiny. It's related to what is the destiny we're going to choose? What is the branch of the tree we're going to choose? And by choosing it, what I mean is, with my choice right now today, I'm choosing the next branch of my tree. So how do I line up that choice with the destiny that I want to create or want to have for myself in the long term? There's so much more we could say about destiny. I'm trying to do it justice in a brief conversation, but if you have more questions about that, I'm happy to answer you.
Any other question for Sky?
I had a question. I don't know if I can express it well, but So you want to be in the flow state, but you said flow. I'm just kind of thinking of Prasuna saying he's in the flow state too much. Is that really possible? That's always something that's worth going for.
Yeah, I think when we're thinking about, when Prasuna, you and I were talking earlier about being in the flow, like with work too much, like not knowing how to divide up a little bit more your day because we're all at home all the time now. And so how do I know when to transition into like having time with my family or downtime for myself to exercise or meditate or whatever it may be? Flow is about our natural transition from state to state. If we're staying in an activity longer than feels healthy for us, and this could be mental health, it could be physical health, it could be health of our family, it could be health of a different project. Maybe I'm staying working on my book when I should be working on my business. Flow is about the ability to stay non-attached to what you're doing enough so that you can see when there's a next right activity, a next thing that needs your attention, and you don't feel stuck. The reason I say stuck on an activity too long is because I'm worried about it. So again, it's about letting go of the worries that are controlling us so that we can actually naturally transition when the time feels right. That's my way of looking at it. So to summarize that, I do think that flow is an experience that when we're in it, we could stay in it all the time and that would be an enlightened state. Because it naturally involves every aspect of our lives. It goes from working to eating breakfast, to taking a shower, to taking a nap, to being with our family. All of these activities are part of our flow when we're at our best.
So thank you for sharing that, Sky. And I think in a while that for bringing that. So one thing, you shared a beautiful story, right? And then there was also flow of emotions in that story. And then there was also a tears that flow, right? So this is kind of my question is like, how is a, and there is a natural flow in the body, right? The blood is flowing and so the question is that do we need to let the flow within the body is directly proportional to flow outside, what we manifest, what do you think about it? So how does it correlate? So in that example, you cried and, emotions flow. So, and then you had a positive outcome. So I was just thinking about on that line. So,
yeah. Well, I like coming back to Rupesh's comment about destiny. I think there's an element of this work that has to do with surrendering ourselves to the hand of destiny. Suffering comes from resisting life, but it doesn't mean that we should just surrender to life and surrender to destiny. There's a very active hand we play. And that's why Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, the author of Flow, talks about transcending the worry about being in control. So it's part of human experience is the full range of human emotion. We're not blocking out any of these things. I think enlightenment is having access to all of those experiences. And when we get ourselves away from enlightenment is when we want to have more of one experience than another. Like if I'm feeling upset and sad about my building project, but I'm not willing to feel upset and sad, I'm going to keep trying to take control and feel angry. So it's an inability to let go of anger and go into my sadness that keeps me from being in flow. But at other times, it might be an inability to go from being sad to being angry that keeps me from being in flow. So it's about being able to more accurately identify how we're feeling and let that be true while it's true.
So the state of being happy and is that the flow, or you can being anger and frustrated is also can be defined as flow? Sky?
I think happiness is the natural transition between anger, fear, happiness, joy, awe, wonder, excitement, sadness. When we're moving through all these things, we have a deeper sense of satisfaction with life. And I think that's what we're really after, that deeper sense of satisfaction. We're not looking for happiness. Who wants to be, you know, in the same mood all the time. We want to be able to move between our moods and feel a sense of certainty in who we are, you know, like a sense of understanding, you know, I think the two most powerful emotions for me are awe and wonder. The more I can stay in awe and wonder, the more I can move through all those other emotions and not get swayed into like suffering about them, being upset.
No, that's amazing. So now I understand, because the flow, actually flow of, you know, and experience of all emotions, actually, that is the flow, that defines the flow. So it's, that's, go ahead.
One of the things I do in that exercise we did often is have you imagine the pinnacle experience of your life. Like this might've been when you graduated from college or high school, or it might've been when you got married, but we've all had an experience in our life where everything was just like, there was no more worrying about it. We were in it. We were having this experience that took us over. And the only things that I can use to describe that are awe and wonder. Like, and within that awe and wonder is all these emotions. Like when I got married, I was nervous. I was afraid. I was overjoyed. I was in love. I was scared. I was sad. You know, all of these things become part of this experience of being alive. And so being in flow is about wholehearted living.
Cool. Thank you. Any other questions or comments on Sky's activity?
It's a really great experience, and Sky just put some very focus on having us listening. I am a climber, so listening to the mountain or listening to the problem, the thing that we are doing. And to listening in a neutral way, this is something which is very, very difficult. And I thank Sky for putting this in logical trees that we can go very forward. Thank you, and thank you, Prasun, for creating this big enrichment of really our mental health. Thank you.
You're welcome, Maurizio. Thank you for sharing that. I think I understood you to say about being able to come at life from a neutral place and see events in your life as neutral rather than good or bad or charged or, you know, rejecting something. Is that right?
No, totally. And we don't judge, and we forget that we are, we can be angry, we can be passionate, and we put in the neutral, like you put in evidence. Yeah.
Yeah, and this ties into what I think Violet asked before around kind of like a witness state. You know, I think a witness is not passionless, but the word that they use in Sanskrit is dispassionate. I mean, that's the English word for it, but dispassionate. It's not passionless. It's a neutral witness-like state, which is nonetheless filled with the life force, like I'm going to do something about this thing in front of me. I'm going to take action. But can I take action without being attached to the results of that action? Satchitananda, my teacher, actually gave an analogy of being attached to the fruit of your labor. And it's great because my metaphor is an apple tree. So it's like if we set up an action and it populates all these apples on the tree, the minute we get attached to one of those apples, an obstacle is going to get in the way and make us get frustrated. So our job is to keep branching out and looking at all the other ways we can get to another apple, because all the apples are just as good as each other. And there's a constant process of letting go of what I'm specific I'm attached to and going back to what do I want to experience in my life.
Thank you very much. And this has been an amazing discussion. Thank you, Sky. Thank you very much.
It has
been a pleasure to have you here, and look forward to participating in your future talks and your, you know, in future activities.
Thank you so much, Preston. Thank you, everybody, for joining and your great questions.